Gotham Insurance Agency. Paula Rattle. Yep, go ahead. So I was going to med school. I ended up getting pregnant my senior year of college with my ex, and it threw me for a loop. He was pre-law, and he got a scholarship to ASU, and I decided that pre-med would not work with a baby and someone that was going to law school. So I did the good mom job. I went and got my bachelor's in education and became a sixth grade teacher. I loved that part, but it killed the entrepreneurial spirit in me. So I kept doing an event decor business at the same time. I'd make more on a weekend than I did all month teaching, which is depressing, but I loved that part of it. So I was a single mom for a number of years after I divorced my ex, and when I met my husband, he was the best thing that ever happened to me as far as getting my confidence back. If you're somebody that grows up with confidence, you have parents that foster that, and then you go through a relationship that breaks it down, there is this recovery that needs to happen, and sometimes you need somebody to step in and go, hey, you're a really awesome person. You just need to do the things that you're supposed to be doing in life, and you feel really awesome about yourself again. And he was that person for me. He called me his diamond in the rough. He said, you just need a little polish, and then that's it. We'll do this together. He's like, what do you want to do? And I'm like, I don't know. I'm like, I don't want to be teaching anymore. I don't want to work on the weekends anymore. And he's like, you don't have to. So he said, figure it out. So I made this chart of all these jobs that I thought would fit with my personality. And it was either real estate, mortgages, or insurance. And so I looked at insurance and I thought, I could educate people. I don't even know what my policy is. Like at all. Like I have no idea what I had. I ended up having 5,150. Not great. I ended up picking insurance. I had an interview with captive carrier, country companies, and decided that would be the fit for me because there was a renewable income. I was not capped. I could be an entrepreneur still within that system, and that I could go out and make my own fortune, but also educate people about the things that matter most to them, their homes, their lives, and their family. And that was really important to me, and so it really spoke to me. So I ended up going to country, and I was like, I'm gonna slam dunk this interview. There's no way I'm not getting this job. So I went and I did the interview, and his name was Skip. So I should tell you a little bit what he did. He skipped over me. And I was like, oh my gosh, I'm like, as a 4.0 student in school, I had a business and I'm smart and that job should be mine. So I was like, you know what? Sometimes your detractors can be some of your biggest benefactors. And I was like, screw that. I'm gonna go track this guy down. So I went to a job fair and I tracked him down and I got in front of him at a booth and he just kind of looked at me like, oh my gosh, like what is this lady doing here? And I said, look, if I am aggressive enough to come and be here today, imagine what I can do for your company. I said, I'm just asking for an opportunity. And I had no idea that insurance was such a male-dominated field until that moment. He said, you're going to an office of 20 men. You'll be the first woman we've ever put in that office. I'm doing you a favor, honey.
Oh, boy.
And I looked at him and I said, I grew up with brothers. My dad was in the Air Force. I was around base guys. It can't be worse than that. Just let me have a chance. Give me an opportunity to show you what I can do. And he said, okay, it's your funeral. I ended up going into that office, and they stuck me in the corner office near the bathroom, and I just decided to put my head down and just take care of people, educate them, be aggressive, go after it, and make it happen. I was one of the top agents within that office within the first month, and I continued to do that, but realized that sometimes you have to make a change. So I ended up going independent in 2003, I started the process of doing that, and found a really great guy, and his name is Ken Walters. And Heather McDougall's here today, she's my COO, she knows him. She always told me, find yourself a good benefactor in your life. And he was that for me in the business. And I went to him full of ego and said, in 2 years I'm leaving you. I'm gonna start my own agency. This is what I'm doing. And he looked at me and he just nodded. He's like, you can do whatever you need to do. He's like, I'll be here to support you. And so I ended up staying, and I ended up buying the agency in 2008, and have been running it since. We now have 23 offices. We have less females than males. And it's something that really bothered me. I'm like, how is it that we have 3 females now, and we have 20 males that run the different locations that we have? I wanted it to change. So about a year ago, I was at a council for a carrier, and I was with a bunch of ladies, and you gotta love it when you get ladies together and they start talking about trying to change the world. They inspire you to do so, and then sometimes you have those conversations where you're just like, oh, that was an awesome conversation, you don't do anything? Well, we had this conversation about how do we empower women? And how do we do that without making men feel like it's them against us? And so I said, I think I wanna start an organization. Because all the organizations I had gone to before, and I love wine. This is, I totally love wine. But it was women whining and whining. I didn't want that. I wanted something totally different. And they're like, you should do that. And I'm like, yeah, I should do that. And then I was like, oh my gosh, I think I'm gonna do this. So I went back and created a group, and we started on Facebook last year. It's almost a year old, and it's called WIISE. It's Women in Insurance Sharing Empowerment. And we include the men. We actually have more men on that page than women, so I'm really proud of that. We interview men about their stories and what they're doing in their offices to help women take those steps, to also help them balance the family issues that we face as well. We call them our benefactors. It's a blend of the word benefactor that I was told to get one a long time ago. I think we all have one out there. We have a benefactor that can help us. So it isn't just the women around us that lift us up, it's also the men as well. So through this process, I started, you know, doing a lot of reading, like a lot of reading about different books. And one of the things that I found with women is sometimes we're our own worst enemy. So we have to be 100% on something before we go for it. We have that all figured out, and if we don't do it perfect, then we beat ourselves up. So a really good book to read is called The Confidence Code. It's one that changed my thinking on how to do things differently with myself and also with some of my female staff. But men, they're 60%, you know, or 50% there, and they're like, I'm doing this. And they have no clue what they're doing, they just go for it. We do not react in the same way. So that needs to change too. We need to push each other when we're not 100%. I love it that at that meeting when we discussed the concept of WIISE, I had a bunch of women that were like, and I had 0% figured out, guys. I had zero. And they're like, you should do that. You should be the person going and doing that for us. Go do that. And then I took the lead. But that was because I had a bunch of people around me that believed in what I was doing. So we definitely need to be pushing each other in directions. You'll never know what it took you. I had no idea I was going to start this at all. But it's been a journey of learning the women's stories. I also think that another thing is that we need to incentivize the people in our organizations, and also companies need to incentivize correctly. Last night, we have a good example of good incentive. We all love the shopping. It was very female-oriented. But I'll tell you, I was really disturbed this year when I went to a carrier award assembly. And there was two top awards. And they hadn't had a female that had ever gotten any of them. And I'm thinking, as we're doing this, that one of them was a fishing trip without your spouse in tents that you share with another person. It's a little uncomfortable. I love the fish. I just went fishing with my dad for 3 days in San Diego with 30 guys. I'm fine with that, but I'm guessing most women would feel a little bit uncomfortable with that type of situation. So that incentive isn't working, and especially if there's no females that have ever gotten it. So then the second award comes up, and I'm like, okay, this has to get better, right? This has to be something that's gender neutral. It's a green blazer award.
Oh, gosh.
And I'm thinking to myself, okay, so if females were dominant in the industry, what would that look like? And I think it's hilarious that we went shopping, because that was the first thing I thought. I'm like, oh, we get a shopping spree with a spa day, and that would be awesome. And we make all the men feel really uncomfortable with getting pedicures. And then I thought, if they had an award, it would be like the Coach Purse Award. Can you imagine giving that to a man? How comfortable would they feel? So when you're incentivizing your team, are you doing it based on gender? And is it appropriate to base on gender? Last night, it's appropriate. We had all females here. And so it makes sense to do it in that situation. But not all times are we in situations where the insurance companies or agencies are incentivizing us correctly. So that's all I got for you, Nicole.
Hello, everybody. I'm Paula Ratliff, and I'm a 19-year agency in Dallas, Texas. And I'm an exclusive agent, so a little bit different. I know half of you in here are exclusive, and I think the other half are independent. But my genesis to become an insurance agent was my relationship with Nationwide. Everybody has a backstory, and my part of my backstory is I was a very outgoing little tomboy, and I loved to play sports. And I was played all of them, and I was pretty good at most of them, and I excelled at a few, and one of those was soccer. And I started playing select soccer when I was 13, and we ended up traveling all over the United States, and then we started traveling internationally, and then I got on a team that was representing the United States in the Women's World Cup for the United States. And this was a time before women were in had soccer in the Olympics, so this was kind of the genesis before women's soccer in the Olympics. So a wonderful experience for me, and the most thing I, other than the travel, the best the learning experience I got from that was being a team player, and what that means to be a team player, and how you have that camaraderie and that team spirit, and you're all working together for the same goal, you know, to win. And we do that in our agencies, right? We're all a team, and we're trying to win that big account or that big bonus at the end of the year or that award. So that was an invaluable lesson for me as a young girl growing up. And I was good enough to get a soccer scholarship to college, but I thought it's the 80s and soccer wasn't even popular with men's sports, so I thought, well, what would I do with that? So I forego that opportunity, but I still wanted to play soccer, and I researched all the universities in Texas. And the only university that had a women's varsity soccer team was Texas A&M. So I became an Aggie. Giga, right? So I played a freshman starter for the first year, and we won every game, and it became less exciting for me, and I realized I needed to focus on my career. And I needed to focus on my career because I didn't have one. I didn't know what I wanted to do, be when I grew up. Started liking and fell in love with this boy who was an architecture major. And I started taking classes with him, and I found out that I was making better grades than him, and I was really good at architecture. So I graduated and I went out into the workforce and interviewed with the fourth largest architecture firm in the country. Very intimidating, but and typically right out of college, you're going to be a draftsperson and you're going to work your way up to be a project manager or a designer. Well, the architect who interviewed me saw something in my portfolio, thought I had talent, and hired me right off to be a designer. And that was a big deal. And not only was that a big deal, it's because I was the first and only female designer in the entire firm. So I found myself surrounded by a bunch of guys in bow ties with really big egos. And that was pretty intimidating, but I held my own, and I learned so many great life lessons and skills that helped me later on. But unfortunately, it was the 90s now, and the SNL savings and loan crisis really took a downturn on the economy, especially in Texas. And companies started downsizing, firms were laying off, and I went from designing skyscrapers to redesigning hotel lobbies. And my boss and my mentor, which again, ladies, it's important to have mentors, and it's okay if it's a guy, a man, they can help you too. But my boss and mentor committed suicide. And I thought, wow, this is not really what I thought I was gonna get into, and it was a depressing time, and I'm a very happy person, and I thought I needed a change. So a friend of mine had been a nationwide insurance agent, and he said, maybe you ought to give this insurance thing a try. And I thought, insurance, like you, isn't that one step above the used car salesman? I thought, wow, I'm a professional, I have a degree. And the guy laughed and he said, well, it, you know, it can be that, but Nationwide is a Fortune 500 company and they're looking for professionals that are college educated and you have to get your licenses to sell financial. And I thought, okay, I'll give this thing a try. So I interviewed and I interviewed very well. I tested out off the charts and they offered me a Nationwide insurance agency. So it's 1998 and now I'm an insurance agent. Now what do I do? I was in a complete loss. I had no idea, like you, I did not read my debt pages. I didn't know anything about insurance. I didn't know how to sell. And I was in panic. And I told myself I'd give this 2 years. And my first year, I was terrible. I was the worst. I was the lowest on all the sales contests. And I'm used to winning. I'm a winner, right? And I was competitive. And I just thought, I've got to figure this out. So I went back to my architecture background. And I said, I'm a builder. I'm used to taking nothing and making something wonderful. And so I started building processes within my agency. I started building sales processes and hiring processes and servicing processes. And then I built this great team around me and I built networks and centers of influence and referral sources. And it just started to turn around for me. And by the end of my second year, I was at the top of all the sales models and I've been there ever since. So once you get the top, you want to stay at the top, right? So how do you do that? You have to grow, typically. So I had a pretty good business model, but I couldn't clone myself, so I hired a bunch of mini-me's, and we opened a bunch of satellites in the Metroplex, satellite offices in the Metroplex, and we went from one office and three employees to 11 offices and 40 employees, and we grew like wildfire. It was a fun, exciting time. We did that for 5 years. And then the internet came, and we found out that our business model had changed. So storefronts weren't as important as they once were, and bricks and mortar are very expensive, so we started downsizing. And now we are down to 2 offices and 10 employees, but remarkably, we were able to stay relatively the same size and keep our bottom line the same. So I would say that part of that success, keys to those successes, embracing the change and always capitalize on the marketplace and diversification. You've got to diversify your portfolio. I mean, if there is the word insurance in it, we sell it. We sell everything insurance. And the idea behind that being that if someone, it's so hard to market and acquire a client, right? And so if you can sell them, build them an insurance portfolio, and hopefully it's good enough that they'll never leave you. You know, of course they do, but you want to have every opportunity to keep that coin. So we sell everything. And the other key important success to my success is my staff. And you got to diversify that too. I'm very proud to say that we're half gals and half guys, and we represent five different nationalities. And I would not be or could not be anywhere to my success if it weren't for them. And you have to praise them and let them know that. But we have had some really great success, and Nationwide has been a wonderful partner. And the structure for me was good. The independent world is so different, and we're starting to learn that now, how different it can be. And there are, you know, great aspects of that too. But like I said, it's just been a whirlwind ride, and I try to share my success and my visions with as many gals as I can in the industry. I have people calling me all the time, like, how are you doing this? What are you doing? And my give back is just sharing the ideas. There's so much to go around that you can't be selfish. You have to share it, and you gotta pay it forward. So I try to do that as often as I can. So thank you.
I'm Mary Falls with Peter Botham. I think probably like most of you, I stumbled into insurance. I had never really planned to do it. I was a VOE, a vocational office education student in high school back in the 80s when a local insurance agency called up and asked for someone to come over and do clerical work. So they selected me. I went over. It was a national brokerage house, Alexander & Alexander. They're not around anymore. They got bought by Aon. But I went over there. This was back in the early 80s, and it was a very different environment. You had a lot of cocktail lunches going on. You had, I remember hearing the comment, just get your skirt to do that. And I like to notice things. I noticed that in this big agency, we had about two stories of a high-rise building. There were only two women that had offices at that time, and one was the HR lady, because you're dealing with personal private information. She had to be able to close the door. And the other was a lady by the name of Vera Dionstadt, and she was kind of the commercial lines guru. Now, Vera D was in her 60s. She was not an attractive woman, no makeup, short hair, glasses. She had two pair of pants, one black, one blue, and she had five tops, and she would rotate. But Vera D had an office, and more than anything else, Vera D had respect. You know, the producers and the principals, they were nice to the ladies in the office, but they didn't matter the way that Vera D mattered. Vera D wasn't attractive, Vera D didn't have money or influence, but Vera D was knowledgeable. She knew those manuals inside and out. And I learned kind of quickly, it doesn't matter what you look like, who you are, if you know what you're talking about. And so that kind of became a role model for me. So I worked there for about 10 years and left kind of the national brokerage firm and went to Higginbotham back in 1995. We were a one-location agency, and I think I was employee number 28. So after dealing with the culture shock there, it was a little bit interesting. You adjust to that and just take it one day at a time. And again, big proponent of education. I think I am very different from any of the other ladies I've heard up here in that I didn't have a supportive spouse. I've been divorced for 21 years, so it was me raising a two-year-old. And working through all of this. So I can remember going to CIC when you had to take the sessions, and they would run till about 5:15, 5:30. I had to leave there as fast as I could and get to the daycare to pick up my son, get him home. We had to feed him, do his homework, give him a bath, and get him to bed. So about 9 o'clock, I could start studying for the CIC. And in those days, it was Wednesday afternoon, Thursday, and Friday, and you take the test very early, Saturday morning. And so I can remember, while I would have babysitters, options. Not many of those young girls wanted to be at my house at 6:45 on a Saturday morning, so I'd pay a lot in those days to kind of get that done. But you didn't think about it in those terms of, oh, this is difficult, this is hard. You just did it because it had to be done. And so just over the years, we have grown from a one location, 28 employee shop, to 26 locations now, and at the end of this year, we'll have 1,000 employees. So. I've seen women really progress and get a lot of opportunities. We're very fortunate to be large like that. So if you have the desire and the ability, at least where we work, we're very fortunate that you do have the opportunity. And so I've been very thankful for things like that. I get to participate in a lot of wonderful events like this and trips.
leaders or I meet ladies like this, and it is so nice to start to see those numbers grow. Because I remember the times being the sole female or the only other females were on the carrier side. And so it's really, really nice to see those numbers grow in advance. It just shows you that I think women are capable of anything and everything.
Sharing your stories. So this is the participation part. We'd like to open it up to questions that you may have for our panel. Does anyone have a question? Holly has one in the back.
What kind of maybe failures or pitfalls or what kind of obstacles did you run into that you could kind of share so that maybe you could avoid them?
During that time when we were growing so fast, we our hiring process within the agency, our main office, was really solid, really good. But when we were growing so fast, we wanted to capitalize on that, and we hired a lot of people that could fog a mirror. And it was somewhat of a disaster. So I think your hiring process is so crucial to what you do, and if you don't have a hiring process, you need one, you need to get one, and you need to keep it the same for everyone. We benchmark personality profiles, and there's a bunch of companies that do that. And when we are hiring, if we're interested in a candidate, they first get interviewed by my staff, because they're going to be working with my staff. And if my staff doesn't like them, they're not going to be successful. So that's the first part. And then if they get through them, they get to talk to me, and if I like them, they get the benchmark to the personality profile. And you'd be surprised what you find in these profiles. You think they tell you that they're a salesperson, and they're not. They tell you that they're a service person, and they're not. You can't lie in these profiles, and you end up not hiring the axe murderers that are just lost. So just think of the cost of a hire. It's very expensive, and if they don't work out, you've lost all that time and money and energy. So your hiring process is really essential.
I'm going to echo that, and I'm going to tell you probably one of my biggest failures ever is I did not have that screening process, and I did not have my why created. And so if Simon Sinek, I love him, and he's got a book called Leaders Eat Last, and it's really good if you have a chance to read it. As you can tell, I'm a total book nerd. But I did not have my one. So I would just be like, hey, you're a captain, you want to go in a minute? I can totally help you. Let's bring you on board. And we grew pretty fast. And then I realized that I had people that I was disconnecting with, and they were problems. And so creating that why really helped capture that. And before I created that why in the hiring process, I actually hired somebody who I just needed, I needed someone just to do servicing. I just needed them in there. And they're like, I just need a really job because I'm a single mom. And as a former single mom, I felt really bad about it. So I was like, oh yeah, my heart, I'm like working with my heart and not my head. I'm like, yeah, let's get you a job. She ended up being a meth head. Oh. I came to the office and we had to call an ambulance because she was foaming from the mouth. And so that's an extreme of it, that you're talking about, the ex-murders or something like that. I mean, it's okay to be a single mom, but other factors need to come into place. So definitely the hiring process, or else you might have to call 911.
I would say what I had to learn is over the years, the more that you can do, the more that people are happy to put on you to do. And women especially, I think, tend to just kind of let things pile up. So I think it's very important to find, and if you don't have them, develop resources to help you so you can delegate. I don't think women easily delegate. It's something I think that you have to learn to do. And if someone's not there, train them in development. Instead of doing it for them, teach them how to do it and bring them along that path with you. And then you've got a resource later on down the road.
So I want to add this, because one of my favorite things that we've done the last, almost this is our fourth year, I think, of doing it with our team, is we do retreats. We actually take them to cabins and we get them out of the office and we get them thinking about how to be innovative. How can we improve things? So if you want to change your environment, get them out of the office. Even if it's just a half day and you go somewhere offsite and you do a fun activity with them and let them tell you what needs to be improved on it and break them out and give them the say to it. And then you tell them that they have ownership in that, that you're not the one that's fixing the problem. You're not the one that's going to be implementing it, that they have rights to innovate. We have a thing called innovations, and it's part of one of the matrices that we measure our team on, is what are they doing with their innovations? How are they improving the company as a whole? And that's, it's a measurement for them to, you know, get, you know, a raise. So that's been a really fun thing that we've been able to do with our teams.
Also too, it's really important to know the culture of your agency. You know, what is your culture? Are you a basketball team? Are you fast paced? Do you sell? Or are you a baseball team and do you nurture your clients and round out your accounts and all those things? And it's important that your staff know what your culture is too and communicate that. And I think the panel yesterday, they talked about your vision statement and your mission statement. You know what that is. Make sure your staff knows what that is, because you want to create the culture that works best for your success. So I mean, just make sure that they know what that culture is.
Can you talk a little bit about the sales side and either how being a woman has, I guess, challenges you've overcome for being a woman or advantages you've seen in the sales process for being a female?
So my favorite thing is when I walk in and they underestimate me. I'm like, you have no idea who you're dealing with. I'm gonna blow your mind on, especially like commercial accounts. I like to do that with a lot of our team and go in there and go, I'm gonna listen for a while. And actually, we talked about this yesterday. My favorite thing to say to clients is, okay, so insurance is a journey. You've been on this journey without me. And I want to learn where you've been before, where you are right now, and where do you want to go in regards to your company and how insurance has played a part in that. I want to be your insurance partner. I'm the best free employee you'll ever have. So the first thing we have to do is, you may come with some insurance baggage. So let's just try and figure out how we can check it and never ever take out that bag again. And you just let them talk to you in that sales process. And they will tell you exactly everything you need to know to sell them. And they will tell you all the obstacles. You'll find out right away if they think insurance is like the worst thing in the world. So you will know what your battle is. But they'll also tell you what they value about it. They will tell you the good things too. So you can use that as well. So that's been my biggest sales tool in that process. And then I would say the second thing is, if you have a team, is to always make sure that they understand how you're measuring them in their workflow. Make sure you have a way to measure the workflow, that you know exactly what the process is, you can time it, date stamp it, you know how much that is in that. Because sometimes some people will say, hey, I'm really overwhelmed, and you have no idea how they're overwhelmed unless you have a system that you can measure it. And once you do that, sometimes you find out they're not even overwhelmed at all, and then you can show them, like, hey, you have like 6 tasks a day. Like, I don't think that's that bad. Or you can see somebody that has like 30. And then you have a true idea of where they're at in that workflow for the sales process.
I think today sales are a bit twofold. I think the sales aspect maybe opens a door for you. But once you get in that door, I think it's your knowledge and your ability that come into play. I think that the client has to feel that confident that you have the ability to do it, and then they have to trust that you can do that on their behalf. If someone's having pain, let's say it's claim issue that's not getting taken care of, no one ever says, give me a salesman. No, give me someone that knows how to fix this problem. And so I think that's kind of the way that I go in on my particular book, to kind of focus in on things to make that sales. I'm selling who I am and what I bring to the table.
As far as, you know, I am a salesperson, so I do that. I like to go out and I like to network and I like to make rain and I like to make relationships and I like to leverage those relationships into possible business opportunities. But not everybody's like that. I'm not the most nurturing person, but that's such an essential part of the business that we're in. So I hire people that are that way. So we have a pretty cut division in sales and service in our agency. I feel like it's two different personalities, but you need both. And I found that now it's not really a gender, it's a personality. So I try not to go in any sales as a woman, as a gender. I just come in like, hey, I'm going to be the best salesperson that you'll ever be around, and I'm going to take care of you, and this is what we have to offer, and you'll never leave. So you just, that's kind of how I go at it, and I think that's important, because when you start doing this gender thing, I think people notice that, and it can be maybe construed awkwardly.
I'm trying to deal with technology, and I have a lot of people that come and want to sell me something that doesn't work. So I'm trying to figure out how to identify the best software, the best phones, even how to make my office more virtual, because I don't want to pay any more in rent, but I need to make myself known to a lot of people. So I'm trying to figure out how to embrace that, how to get that information.
Well, that's the bane of my existence, probably all of ours, right? I mean, that's just a complete nightmare. And this agency management system, now we've gotten one. And I would just tell you that there's a marketplace out there, and there's so many vendors that want to get to you, and they want to sell you their product. So you just need to interview, you talk to your peers and see what they have. And then, you know, narrow it down to maybe top three agency providers of agency management systems or phone systems. And then interview those three, and then just find out who's going to give you the best deal and the best pricing and the best software and all that technical stuff, and then go back to your peers and say, okay, well, I got this pricing, can you compare it to yours? And then just talk to your peers. And we have a group, it's a CEO group, and we literally spend half of our time talking about technology and how we can leverage that, and which vendors to go to, which ones to talk to, which ones are providing better service, better deals. So, you know, I would just say talk to your other agents.
I would agree with her on that. There's a group on Facebook called IAOA, and it's Independent Agencies Owner Alliance, and you can put those questions out there. There's also, you can also search based on keywords, and you can find a lot of information on technology. But with technology, it's like overload. You're like, oh my gosh, there's so much to choose from that it's almost, you get paralyzed by it. So what I would suggest is really know your process, because even the technology that we use in our office, we've taken it and tweaked it to make it work for us. Know what your sales process looks like, what you want the steps to look like, down to even like in our management system, we took the documentation portion and we created folders that allow it to show the sales process. So we have submission and indications in one folder, and just kind of, and then we go into finding docs and invoices, so it's nice and clean. It was nothing that the vendor that we use gave us. This was something that we took, and we would see it. Know somebody that loves technology too. So I have a really great millennial in my office, Albert. I'm like, give it to them. And I told him, I said, hey, we have three systems right now that we're using. I would really like it down to two. So he spends his time over the weekend, right? And he comes back, and he's totally jonesing. He's like, hey, he's like, I figured it out. I'm like, awesome, I didn't have to. And he's like, and I got us down to one. I was like, you got us down to one. I only asked him to get us down to two. He's like, I know how to take these systems and integrate them all to one, and I'll show you how. So I can get rid of that decision, find somebody else that really loves it, let them do it, and figure it out, because I was really going to be happy with two.
I'm not really a technology person, but I do know that what we've done over the years when we consider certain systems is go out, and other agents are very helpful. Get their opinion, ask them, find out what works and what doesn't work. We found that from an agency management system, several of them are written from an accounting aspect, and then other things flow in. If you can find one that's written from a sales aspect, we found that to work so much better, because you really don't need to do much accounting if you can't sell much. So.
Ladies, thank you so much for doing this, and we're so lucky to have you here with us. I feel very proud to have you here. One of you mentioned earlier about incenting agents in the right way, and this is something I think all carriers struggle with, is agency incentives and what works. So this isn't necessarily a gender-specific question, but I'm interested in your thoughts on, is there a completely different way we should be going about thinking of agent incentives?
So we had incentives, and I thought they were really going to work for our team, and they weren't selling, and I didn't understand it. I was like, okay, what's going on here? Like, this is awesome. Like, providing like a really cool thing for them, and what they really needed was that they needed it broken down more on a weekly basis. They needed to see that they were achieving on a weekly basis, on a monthly basis, and not just a yearly basis. That the year goal sounded so far away to achieve it that it was going against them. So what I did was we sat and I said, hey, you guys are going to figure out what we're going to do for incentives. And it's a mix of male and female. And we put them in the room. And we said, just don't come out until you guys got it figured out of what you want, because I'm tired of incentivizing and feeling like you're get pushback. And it's almost like you grudge it at that point in time. So then it becomes ineffective on both sides. So we put them in the room, and they figured out they wanted a weekly goal, so they understood what that was. If they achieved it, then they get X. They had a monthly goal, they achieved it, they got this, and then we have it broken down for them. The yearly one was less important to them than something that was sustainable. So I know that's what worked for us, is just getting the feedback on what it is that they really, really want.
We try to do both. We try to do individual incentives and team incentives. And you really gotta tap into your staff, because what some person thinks of incentive, it really isn't. So some salespeople are driven by, you know, I want money. How much more money can I make? And so you set up those types of incentives for that type of personality. But some people, you know, want a day off, or they want to wear jeans on Friday. I mean, you'd be surprised what people really want as an incentive. So you just kind of have that dialogue and that conversation with your staff. But I find it very helpful to do both the individual and the team. And then, that way you're working towards your own goals, but the team also has an idea of where they need to be. That's become really helpful for me.
I would say just making sure that you get it to the firsthand level that you want to receive it. As an example, we get a lot of overrides that might come to the house. That really doesn't incentivize those people working at the desk, because they don't see or feel that difference. So if there's a commission increase paid at the policy level, then that producer feels that immediately because they're paid on commission. If it's small business online input, then you want to give it to those people that are actually doing that input. So gift cards, incentives, whatever those might be there. And they can be different within a company. But I think if you get it directly to those people as opposed to something to the house, it's going to have much more impact.
We are struggling with the millennials, and we get them in the office, we train them, and they stay for 1 or 2 years and then they leave, which is costly. So I didn't know if you guys have any brilliant ideas on helping with that generation.
We have two. And they are definitely a different animal, but they've done surveys that millennials are very entrepreneurial, and they can do a lot of tasks all at once. So, you know, you don't want to bore them, that's for sure. But, you know, again, it goes back to your hiring processes and those personality profiles, and I think that if you benchmark those things to what you want in the organization, you're going to find millennials that will be able to work in your organization. If you just go out and say, I need to hire some young people, you know, that's probably not going to work for you. So again, you go back to your hiring process, and that just seems to be our fail-safe for us.
We did a big change for us was that we went from a family concept to a team concept, and within that team, it's really important for our millennials that they feel like they're involved in that change. Our industry is not receptive to them, I think, because there's a lot of agencies that haven't changed. We just did an acquisition of an agency that had 3 rooms of filing cabinets, not paperless, doesn't even have a management system really in place, and I wanted to hyperventilate, and so I had to bring a bunch of millennials in there and go, I need you to fix it. Like, and we need to make a change. I'd like to be responsible for those changes, but they need to see that we're not just doing it the way we did it the last 30 years. So if your office looks like what it did 30 years ago, you're going to need to change the way it looks, because they'll walk in there. explain what your office looks like and how do you attract people that want to have that change and that are tech savvy, and give them the ability to help you go through that process if you have to make that change, because they're eager to do that. They want the ownership of it. Like you said, they're a little bit entrepreneurial. They want to have that. That's why we do our innovations with them, because then they get to decide what it is. And sometimes those innovations are classes. Like some of them are like, hey, I really would like to know more about certificates. And like, cool, what are you going to do that? And then they're like, I think I want to go to a class. And then you have them go to a class. But it came from them instead of going, you need to give some information on certificates, you kind of suck. Like, it's a totally different conversation there that's going to be happening with them. Let them make the decision, because they think they know everything. They do. So you can kind of use it to their advantage. So it'll break down those walls of them, because it comes from them internally instead of you telling them what to do.
I think the millennials that we deal with and experience, they thrive on praise. Mm-hmm. They want to be successful. They want to compare themselves to their peers rising quickly. They want to, you know, I have a college degree, I should be a vice president. Those types of talents. But if you can figure out ways to make them feel successful and praised, then I think they're less likely to go out and seek something. For producers, we have mentors that will work with them, but the mentor gets a piece of whatever it is that they sell as well. So they're incentivized to help them. So their numbers grow along with them, but it helps them kind of achieve those numbers a little bit quicker. They feel successful. They get praise when they write new business. And as far as the in-house marketer, CSR, we kind of, I think if you can create multiple levels that I can advance to level one, level two, level three, I feel like I'm moving. I don't have to go outside to advance or to keep up with my peers. I can move a little bit quicker, whether you just keep the same positions and just add two or three more levels on there. I think that just gives them that feeling of progressing quickly.
And they're going to want all the technology. They're going to want two desktop screens. They're going to want their laptop, their iPad, their cell phone, and they're going to be looking at all of it all the time.
Good information on millennials. I have a few, so thank you. Y'all have talked about predictive indexes that you use for finding the right employee. Can y'all tell me what system or what test that you use and about how much they cost?
We use Omnia Profile, and I buy it in bulk, so you get a better price if you buy more. And I don't buy that anymore. I have my agency manager do that, so I don't know the cost, but I can definitely get that information to you. One of the gals on the panel yesterday mentioned MindWire, and that really piqued my interest because that sounded like a really good one, possibly better than what I'm using. So, but there's so many out there. Nationwide uses Limra, I think, still, so that might be a good one. But you kind of just, what they do is they'll come and they'll let you take the test, and then you can find out what your personality is, and then you decide whether that was good info. And if you like the test based on what you saw out of your personality, that's probably the company to go with.
We don't use that. We decided a couple of years ago to use a different concept. We call it the Dream Team Invitation. And we have these postcards. And we call our team the Dream Team. I let them name it. And what it is on the back of that invitation, they can hand it out to anybody that they think might be a good fit for our team. So you're constantly recruiting. And on the back of that invitation, it says, you're invited to dream your dream job. And it says, what kind of environment would you work in? What kind of skills would you be using to feel awesome at? And what kind of people would you be working with as well? What would they look like? So these are the type of questions that we have on the back of it. It gets them outside of it. It gets people to recruit for you on a consistent basis. I've gotten some really interesting things back. We actually had one person when we first started this out apply, and they went through it. They're like, I think I need to be a nurse. I'm like, wow, that was way different than we thought you would be going for, but I'm happy for you because I think this is my dream job. And so it has a really unintentional reactions from people, but we've been able to kind of help with the type of people that we want to, and trying to create that culture by asking those questions, because everyone wants something a little bit different, and it will give you an idea of who they are coming from them.
I agree with what Paula said. Take that test yourself and really evaluate that. I was, when one of the ladies mentioned that there was one that was about 6 minutes, I was so jealous. jealous. The one I took was like 30 minutes, and it was hard. It had geometry. It was awful. It was accurate, but it was tough. So I would definitely say to take that yourself. The other thing that we do is once they get through that process, you know, we have them interview with a few people, and my boss and I like to just throw some things at them where it's kind of how would you solve this problem? Come in, okay, the internet is down. We need to know how tall the Statue of Liberty is. How are you going to find the answer to that question? And if they're millennials, they're just, look at you, they're like stuck. But see if they can actually have the thought process to work through how to solve that problem in front of you. I think that shows a lot as well.
Would you share a little bit, when you were a small agency, about your growth strategy? What worked for you? Was it hiring agents? Was it hiring someone to manage your staff? What was successful for you?
Well, for me, because I'm more of a sales acumen, I needed someone that could run my agency. So I was really looking for an office manager or an agency manager, someone who could do the technology and actually input the data to do the policies. You know, I would just bring in the client and they go, here, do it. And it takes a special person to be able to do that. And you go through a lot of heartache, but I've had my agency manager for 15 years and he's wonderful. He's nurturing, he's a guy and he's nurturing, but he's really good at what he does. And you always hire to your weaknesses. So, because you know you can do what you can do, but you can't do what you can't do. So, hire to your weaknesses. Your staff is just essential in everything you do.
I would definitely say one of the things that worked really well for me is I really like creating relationships with people that can be referral sources for us. So, create raving fans out there. Find mortgage companies. Find financial agents that don't do what you do, and create that outside lead source for yourself. We've created programs within commercial, so then the leads are automatically coming into you, and then you can staff for the inside sales portion of it, and you can grow a lot faster that way by doing it, and then you're just nurturing a couple of relationships out there, because as you start off, it's really great, and your first customers, like, they have, you know their address, you know their phone number by heart when you're first starting out, but as you grow, it gets harder and harder, and you get more and more clients, and that can feel overwhelming. So you can get the staff that can take care of that stuff, but you can take care of specific relationships that are outside sales relationships that will feed it into your agency. So that's been the biggest growth for us, is just finding the right partners that believe in what you're doing and that they believe, like ours, if they don't believe that we're going to take care of them and protect what matters most, and they're just like, give me the cheapest, that's not going to be a referral partner that you'll want to, you know, partner with. You want to make sure they have the same mindset. Or else, you know, I've taken on referral partners where I'm like, okay, this is not a good fit because they just don't go where I go in regards to taking care of people.
Thank you. There's also a lot of recruiting companies that will help you, but, you know, they're expensive. So we've used them. But also, too, believe it or not, we've hired some of our clients. you know, you get to know them, and they've between jobs, and possibly they need an opportunity, and we've hired clients. Children. So I've hired a gal who was a waitress at a restaurant that I went to, and she was phenomenal. I said, do you like this job? And she goes, it's okay. I said, do you want a career? And she said, in what? And I said, well, it's in insurance. I said, here's my card. Call me and come talk to me. And she ended up being one of my best sales gals that I had for a long time. So you never know where that opportunity is going to be.
Back when we were the single location, 28 employee shop, what I noticed that they did was put really, really strong management people in place and then just go focus entirely on sales. Those strong management people will figure out how to keep that going, how to keep that moving. The other thing I would say is if you're not already selling multiple lines, if you can sell that client PNC and life and health and whatever else might be out there, the less likely they are to leave. It's harder to sever just one piece of a relationship. So anytime you can do that to cross-sell and further entrench yourself with that client, I think that helps you too.
Perfect. We have time for one more question. I think we've got one more back there in the back.
Thank you. I'm a really really small agency, and I'm just wondering, do you pay your sales staff salary plus commission, or do you pay them straight commission?
Well, it depends. If they're in-house, we pay them a base plus commission. If they're outside sales and satellite, they work 100% commission. So, and you'd be surprised. Don't be afraid of that model. There are people that are very driven in the sales acumen. I mean, you work on 100% commissions, right? So there's other people that will do that too. So don't be afraid to hire someone that's willing to do that. And I'd be happy to share my model with you or anyone here on how I was able to make that work. But yeah, it's tough being smaller because you got to do all things. But again, 100% commercial commission person is not free, but they can get you places where you would maybe have the salary and the funds to buy a salary of an employee.
And we're actually set up the same way as you, is how we do it. There's the ones that run their own locations are 100% commission, and then the inside people have a base plus the bonuses that we do with on individual and then team effort.
We've always actually been 100% commission. You eat what you kill. And we're very excited when people get married and have babies, because then all of a sudden they need to go sell more. So we're very much for that. We do a lot of matchmaking and things like that to keep that going, to keep them hungry. But we also have the mindset of too much of a comfortable salary base. You get what I call kennel-fed dogs who forget how to hunt. They're not necessarily as hungry. So we're very much focused on keeping that. You know, that's how they get a raise, is they go sell more.
Awesome. First off, please give all of these people a round. I want to thank you all for participating today, sharing your story, and sharing your successes with us. So thank you all very much. We are going to take a quick break. Please be back in the room and in your seats.